got his PhD at UC Berkeley in 2010, working with Alex Bryant in mobile sensing technology related to traffic flow. And right before that, you had you studied physics in France with the Quantum Master. So without further ado, please welcome our speaker today.
Thanks very much for the introduction, and thanks again for inviting me here. It's my pleasure to be here in Atlanta for this presentation. So today I'm going to talk about network traffic state estimation using Hamilton-Jacobi equations. So it's some ongoing work that I'm doing with my PhD student, and it's about estimating the state of traffic on highways using some exact methods. So I'm going to first focus on estimating problems using Hamilton-Jacobi equations, so how to compute fast solutions to Hamilton-Jacobi equations, how to extend this to traffic estimation problems, and how to finally extend this to networks, and I will show a mixed integer in our programming formulation on how we can solve actually exactly traffic state estimation. So to start, I will first talk a little bit about the model. So we are going to focus on the NWR model. I don't know if you have heard about this, but it's a commonly used model for traffic flow estimation or control. So it's a model that was derived in the 1950s by Lanty, Witham and Richard. It's based on the conservation equation. So this conservation equation states that vehicles don't appear or disappear from the highway. And in addition to this equation, this equation is actually d rho over dt plus dq over dx equals 0, where q is the flow. But we are inputting actually a relationship that is here that states that the flow is directly related to the density of the highway. And this relation is really the debatable part of the model. So the conservation part is right. Cars don't appear or disappear, that's we know for sure. But now the relationship between flow and density, that's something that's more or less empirical. That's called the fundamental diagram. And we assume that this relationship holds, but in reality, actually, there is quite a bit of scatter of points, so it's not exactly true. The assumption that we make, though, is that the fundamental diagram psi is assumed to be concave. So we assume that that's the relationship here is described by the concave function. And equivalently, instead of working with densities and flows as the NWR model, we can work with the integral form, which is known as Moskowitz function. Here, this is the M function that you see here. This M function can be thought of as the integral of the flow or density. So it represents numbers of vehicles instead of representing densities or flows, which are number of vehicles per unit space or unit time. We are integrating these vehicles, so we get actually numbers of vehicles. And the Moskowitz function is defined such that the derivative, the special derivative of the Moskowitz function here is equal to the density, so this corresponds to the density. This temporal derivative of the Moskowitz function corresponds to the flow. That's what you can get from this integral equation. And obviously, now if you input the relationship flow is equal to a function of the density, you get that dl over dt is equal to a function of the density, which is this. So this represents an Hamilton-Jacobi equation which describes the flow. So instead of having an equation that was this equation, this is the NWR PD, you get this equation here, which is just the integral form, and we just take that q is equal to the size of the flow. And the physical interpretation of this function is as follows. So imagine that you have a highway here. Imagine that you have vehicles on the highway that are labeled by increasing order. So this is vehicle number 1, number 2, number 3, 4, 5, 6. The Moskowitz function corresponds to the the Moskowitz function depends on points t and x. So at t and x, what we look at is what is the label of the vehicle that is close to the label t and x. So for example, if I fix the time, if I fix t, I freeze the cars on the highway, they are located like that. So if I freeze the time, this is how the Moskowitz function would look like over space, because these are the positions of the vehicles. So So it's a discontinuous function because labels are integers. But we do an approximation in which we assume that the function is continuous because we deal with very large number of labels. So in the end, the discrete part doesn't show up that much. So now, to compute the solution to this model, we have many ways to be able to compute solutions. So that's an important part because, as you know, when you are dealing with control or estimation problems, it's very important to have a fast way of computing the solution to the problem, or equivalently, it's important to have a way to represent the constraints of the model or of the measurement data to the problem that you have. And you need to find a way to encode this, this effect of the model somehow. So if you want just to do forward simulation, and that's what we're going to focus right now. So forward simulation means that you have your initial and boundary conditions and you want to compute the solution to the PDE. You have many methods to use. So you can use, for instance, the Godunovsky for AWR. Equivalently, that's known as the CTM, self-transcription model. That's the same thing. You can use also the wavefront tracking method, for instance, in which you are looking at the evolution of waves that are generated by blocks of initial or boundary conditions. You can look also at other finite difference schemes, which are, so Godunov is a finite difference scheme, but you have higher order schemes, for instance, essentially non-oscillatory schemes, weighted essentially non-oscillatory, etc. If you want to deal with the Vittel-Jacobi equations, you can have standard first order numerical schemes, like Lex-Gregoris or Lex-Gregoris scheme. You have also something that was introduced recently, a few years ago by Laganzo, which is the variation method. So it's based on a dynamic programming formulation of the solution to the problem. And what we're going to focus on today is a semi-analytic method, which is actually an evolution from the variation method that applies only for homogeneous problems, i.e. problems in which the fundamental diagram depends only on the density, but it doesn't depend on space or time. So here's how it's going to work. So first, let's see how we can define a problem itself. So in a problem, I'm going to encode the initial boundaries and also possibly internal conditions of the problem as a given function C. So for example, here, this function C will represent the value of the solution that I would like to impose on some domain. For example, in the domain in red, so this is the space, this is the position, so this is the location of the vehicles on the highway, this is time. And so if you look at this space-time domain, you have actually some measurement data, and the measurement data tells you that the Moskowitz function will need to have some value at some location. So for example, if I just get initial conditions, the initial conditions will tell me how the vehicles are located at the initial time, so on this line exactly. And I want to include that information. So we know that there will be a function of space here that will describe me how the vehicles are located. Similarly, in time, if I have a sensor that tells me which vehicle entered at which time, I also know this function here. I know the downstream boundary condition if I have another sensor here. I may know also that some vehicles are having some trajectories, but because they are the same vehicles, their labels should be the same. I mean, if the vehicles are not fast, of course. If the vehicles are always keeping their labels, then I know that that this should have a constant label. So now, if I have all this information together, I encode everything as a function C here. And this function depends, obviously, on space and time. But what is important is that this function is not defined everywhere. It's just defined on some subset of the space-time domain. And if once I define this function C, what I have as a result is that we can use the Laksov formula, which is exactly the same thing as what is used in the variational method. So there's nothing new here. And the Laksov formula tells me that actually the solution of the problem at any location tx is the solution to a minimization problem. So it's the solution to the minimization over the variables u and t of this function here. So u and t have to belong to some domain, so it's constraint minimization, and the objective function is u. So now for each point tx that I want to compute the solution on, I just have to actually compute the solution to this problem, and I will the solution to this minimization problem, I will get the solution. So here in the function that you are dealing with, phi star corresponds to the convex transform of the Flux function. So it's a Legendre-Lemschel transform. And I have also based on this formula before. I have a secondary property that is very important, that's known as the uniformity property, that tells me that if I want to break down my problem, so if I want to break down the function C as a minimum of a bunch of other functions, so if I can say that C is actually the minimum of C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, etc. to C12, then I have that the solution at any point Cx is equal to the minimum of the solutions that would correspond to each subproblem. So for instance, if I want to compute the solution at time Tx, I can solve the equation before, I can solve the problem before, and I can get the solution. I can alternatively solve the problem before here, but I replace C by C1. I will get something. So if I replace C by C1, I just take this as the function C, and I just get the solution in Tx. I can replace it for C2, C3, C4, C4, etc. Each time I will get a different result. And I just have, by this property, that the solution, the value of the function f at each point Tx, will be equal to the minimum of all these values that I will have computed. So right now, it still doesn't help quite that much, because we still have to solve the limitation problem at each time. But actually, that's actually very helpful. So here, as an example, I showed here all the solutions induced by these functions here, and I know that if I have this initial problem now, I just have to find the minimum of all the functions to get my solution. So, for example, on the typical initial boundary condition problem, so you have an initial condition here, you have some density that is defined here. This density influences the domain and it defines some profile there. Now if I have more, for instance, an upstream boundary condition block, I define something else. And another block of initial density, I define something else in green too. I define something else again in blue. And now if I have this problem corresponding to this initial condition and boundary condition, the problem is the free encoding of these four functions, and I just have to take the minimum of these four functions to get the solution. So how does it help? How does it help? It helps because there's a new property that states that if you have actually an affine, i.e. linear initial condition or boundary condition, then the solution to this problem can be computed super fast. So what is important for us now is to see how you can compute the solution to a linear block. So technically it's a non-physical or non-mathematical problem. Because you have, for example, it's a non-physical problem. For instance, I just defined an initial condition here that states that the density at that point between these two points in average is equal to some value. Outside of that, I don't define anything. I don't know what's happening. I don't define zeros. I just define that I don't know what's going on outside of this domain. So if I just want to focus on this specific problem, I can define an initial condition that is defined like this. So it tells me that between alpha I bar, alpha I plus 1 bar, my density is equal to minus AI. Outside of this domain, I have no information, which means that I have to define as plus infinity. I can define the upstream boundary condition in the same way. My flow is equal to Cj between the times gamma j bar plus 1. Downstream boundary conditions can be defined in the same way. And what is interesting is that if I take any of these problems, I can solve them exactly. So for example, if I focus on the initial condition, I take this function, I plug it into the Laplace formula that I defined before. So when I plug it into the Laplace formula, I will get this problem actually. So instead of having two optimization variables, I can actually break down the problem, reduce the problem into a single variable problem. So I will have a 1D optimization problem, I minimize over a single variable. And in addition to that, this problem is very simple because it's convex. So here, you have a linear function of u, so u is my optimization variable around here. So it's a linear in u, and this part is convex in u because phi star is convex, t is positive. So you have actually a convex optimization problem that is 1D. So you have u is also belonging to a convex set, and this is the intersection of a convex domain with an interval, so that's convex. So, so what is interesting is that now if I optimize, if I want to solve this problem, I will get just a convex function that can have x and all, but I can easily find the solution to this convex problem analytically. So to find the solution to the convex problem, technically what you would do is you would compute the derivatives. You would look at when the derivative is equal to when the derivative is equal to zero, and you would define cases. For instance, if the derivative is inside the, for instance, if your domain is like this, just have to see if the function is increasing, etc., and see what's the minimum. For the prime that we have, it's slightly more complicated because we are using functions that are just convex or concave. They can also have kinks. They are not necessarily differentiable. So you have to use the concept of subgradients. Subgradients are an extension of derivatives for convex functions, but they work exactly in the same way. So instead of having that a function is minimum if the derivative is equal to zero, you have that a function is minimum if zero belongs to the subgradient of the function. So bottom line, we can actually compute the solution at all points in space and time, exactly using a formula. So you can just get a formula that allows you to compute the solution for an initial condition that is linear and compute that solution exactly. And the solutions make sense if you look at them. The structure of the solution is very familiar for people that have been working with AWR. For example, if I define just an initial condition here within this domain, I will have, as before, the characteristic domain. I will have funds forward and backward. I will have for an upstream boundary condition, similarly, a forward fan, the characteristic domain, backward fan, and same for the downstream condition. For a moving bottleneck, I will still have a characteristic domain, upstream, downstream, and the densities associated to these domains match exactly the ones that you get from the moving bottleneck theory. That's exactly the same thing. There's nothing is new there. You will have some fans, and you can have also some dropouts. So that's how the solution will look like in general when you solve it for it. And because of the isomorphism property, you can now stack all these solutions together that are explicitly defined and just compute the minimum of these functions. So now let's get to the problem of data fusion. So what we want to focus on right now is not just doing forward simulation, because forward simulation is good when you want to compute the solution at a given time, but what you want to do is actually to solve the problem of estimating the state of traffic. So let's get back to the mathematics of it. So when you want to solve the problem with mathematically, what you have to define is you have to define an initial condition, maybe upstream and downstream boundary conditions. So this is called the Dirichlet problem. And that's something that is really a mathematical formalism, to say that if you have a partial differential equation, that's how you should do things. The problem is that, now let's just talk a little bit about the problem. So the problem is that in reality, it doesn't happen. So when you have data that you have to deal with in terms of traffic estimation, your data is coming from a variety of sensors. The data is not necessarily making all your initial condition and your boundary conditions, no, because there is no certainty that your domains will contain sensors at the upstream downstream boundary conditions. The initial condition typically is very hard to get, because if you have sensors that tells you your initial condition, why don't you just run your sensors all the time and don't do even this estimation? I mean, you have all the data that you need. So usually the initial condition is completely unknown. So what we have usually is just a fragment of data. We might have, for instance, a density sensor data that tells you that the density, the average density in some domain is equal to some value. It's going to repeat these measurements every, say, 30 seconds, 1 minute. You will have maybe some trajectory data from a car sensor. You might have some travel time data that tell you that a car that entered at that time left at another time. Or this travel time data might be inside the domain too. I mean, you might have a variety of things. You might have also some part of flow data too, and sensors might be faulty at some other time. So you are facing this problem of having a bunch of very heterogeneous data to deal with and to incorporate this data into the model. So the issue that we have with this data is first that this data doesn't allow us to necessarily say what's the most coherent function on this measurement data points. For example, when I'm dealing with data captured by cell phones, I cannot say exactly what's the value of the most coherent function in that domain. I cannot define an internal condition with the exact value of the most coherent function, simply because I don't know it. If you look at, for instance, this case, I have cell phone, so if I wanted to define an internal condition, I would need to define this function. But this function, even though you have some parameters that are known, so the parameters in red, those are, for instance, the times measured by the GPS, the positions measured by the GPS, the velocity, so the GPS, so all these things are known. But the things in green here, I don't know that. That's the label of the car. So what's the number of the vehicle in my Moscovitz function? I don't know about it. There's no sensor. This R coefficient is how many people passed the car during this measurement, or did the car pass people? We don't know it. We don't know this either. So these two things are unknown coefficients describing these internal conditions, and we have to find a way to just deal with this. So to deal with this, here's how I approach the problem. So we have sensor measurement data. These sensor measurement data are there. So the two issues that we have is that these sensor measurement data are inexact, and also there are things that are unmeasurable. So for example, density sensors, they constrain the local density values. So here I have the density sensor. I have a measurement here, but that doesn't mean that the density at that point is equal to the measurement. It might be within a range according to sensor specifications. Same, I have the flow measurement here, but the sensor might be spot, overcount, or undercount. So I might have also some error there. So I have all this measurement data, and given this arbitrary data set, what I want to do is to reconstruct the initial and boundary conditions of the problem to be able to compute what is the density map that we have, and once we have the density map, we have solved the estimation point. What is important here is that we want to reconstruct the set of possible initial and boundary conditions of the parameter. So unlike classical estimation parameters in which we focus on minimizing some specific objective function, for example, if you deal with Kalman filters, you might minimize the errors in the mean square sense, for example. Here, we are completely open. We just want to first find out what are the possible ways to arrange things in terms of initial and boundary conditions so that we are both compatible with the measurement data and with the model.